Well, good afternoon. Welcome to the Henry Jackson Society, our first meeting of the new year. And what a way to begin, frankly, as we have one of Britain's leading historians delivering a lecture on this fine book that you will, of course, be able to purchase outside afterwards with a few wise words imparted by the author. We're delighted, of course, to have Andrew Roberts, a distinguished and old friend of the Society, having been with us right from the start, from the very early days. Andrew's pedigree is really immense. Reaching Churchillian standards, we're getting there, Andrew, given the number of fellowships and other things that you've picked up. But of course, he's got a PhD from Cambridge, a visiting professor at the War Studies Department of King's College London, the Lerman Institute Distinguished Lecturer at the New York Historical Society. He is the Roger and Martha Mertz Visiting Research Fellow at the Hoover Institution at Stanford University. And of course, he has authored 13 books, a number of which have been on the Churchill topic, a number not. He has a long history with the Churchill family and with the organisations to do with Churchill, trustee of the International Churchill Society, for example. And it's fair to say that even with his pedigree, he was taking a bit of a risk writing a one-volume biography on a man who's had over 1,000 biographies written about before. But it's one, if you've read any of the reviews or the book, if you've been lucky enough to buy it already, that has paid off handsomely. Literally a bestseller all around the world. I've never seen so many positive reviews about one book in terms of so many different publications. It's really an honour for us to have you here, Andrew, to share your thoughts. And we particularly wanted to focus on not just the book in itself, but also lessons from Churchill for the contemporary age. So without further ado, Andrew Roberts.
Always display the product. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honour to be invited to address you this afternoon, and thank you very much indeed for coming. And I'd just like to preface my remarks by saying what a great organisation the Henry Jackson Society is. I'm very proud to be connected to it, and also the job that that Alan Mendoza and his team do, I think, is very important in the contemporary politics that we have today. There are very few voices who are brave enough to say the kind of things that that Alan and the HJS do. So congratulations to them. In talking about Churchill's relevance to modern politics, excuse me, I am constrained by a couple of things. The first thing is the obvious fact that Winston Churchill died over 50 years ago, and it is therefore impossible for anyone short of a necromancer to know what he actually thought, would have thought, were he alive today, about anything. And I see we've got Jenny Churchill in the audience. It was, of course, her grandmother, Mary, who said that it is absolutely wrong to ever say what Winston would have done under any particular political circumstance, and so one must always remember that. Having said that, there are of course various areas of politics that we pretty much do know what Churchill would have thought about things. His Zionism, for example, he was a philo-Semite who believed in the State of Israel as a national homeland for the Jews, somebody who supported the Balfour Declaration and who had grown up with Jews, who liked Jews. His father had been friendly with Jews. And it was one of the things, of course, that gave him an early warning system when it came to Hitler and the Nazis, that an awful lot of his contemporaries, of his the people of his age and class and background, simply did not have, because they were more or less anti-Semitic in those days. So I think we can take it for granted that Winston Churchill, were he alive today, would be a continued supporter of the State of Israel. I think we can also take it for granted that he would have the same kind of disdain for opinion polls that he had in those days. He was somebody who led from the front. He never had any spin doctors. He never had any need for focus groups one of the things that I have against the movie The Darkest Hour, which I love, by the way, a great movie, and I thought Gary Oldman was wonderful in it. Nonetheless, the underground scene implied that he was following public opinion rather than leading it. Ladies and gentlemen, that did not happen. It was the other way round. He was leading rather than following it. And his stance on opinion polls was brilliantly summed up in on page 625. literally one sentence. Don't worry, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not about to rant on for 1,000 pages. But this in particular I thought was a wonderful line of his, in which he said, page wrong, needless to say. It's a speech on the 30th of September 1941, where he joked about politicians who cared too much about public opinion to show proper leadership. And he said, this is in the House of Commons, "Nothing is more dangerous than to live in the temperamental atmosphere of a Gallup poll, always feeling one's pulse and taking one's temperature. I see that a speaker at the weekend said that it was a time when Britain, when leaders should keep their ears to the ground. All I can say is that the British nation will find it very hard to look up to leaders who are detected in that somewhat ungainly posture." I have given speeches about this book a lot in the United States, as you can imagine, and I'm constantly asked about what Winston Churchill would have thought of Donald Trump. Again, it's completely impossible to say for all of the reasons I've given already. One thing I do believe, however, is that Churchill would have been extremely good on Twitter. Many of his most brilliant aperçus, his great put-downs, his defence against hecklers and so on, can easily be summed up in 280 characters or fewer. When somebody shouted at him in a speech he was giving in Manchester, all the heckler shouted was the word rot. Winston Churchill immediately replied, "I thank my friend for telling me what's in his mind." He was also able, of course, to make great non-political jokes as well. When his private secretary, Jock Colville, came to him and said that their cook had been made pregnant as the result of a nocturnal assignation with a man in the street in Verona, Winston Churchill immediately replied, "Obviously not one of the two gentlemen." I think the events yesterday, where Mrs. Soubry was attacked aggressively and violently by thugs, would have immediately produced a great denunciation from Winston Churchill. Entirely regardless of Mrs. Soubry's political opinions, he was a true believer in tough debate, undoubtedly, but in a bipartisanship of general gentlemanliness in discussions, which absolutely went to the heart of his very character. He would have hated and despised what happened yesterday, just as anybody who believes in proper democratic debate should do. He was, of course, somebody who, when he set up the other club in 1911 with F.E. Smith, was capable of saying that no rules of this club should interfere with the rancour and asperity of party politics. He believed in party politics. However, there was a point at which it was unacceptable to go, and I'm afraid we saw that yesterday, and I hope it isn't a harbinger of things to come between now and the end of March of this year. I think also that we have in Churchill, I'm sure I'm going to be asked about the European question at some stage, so I've put that back until it comes, because Churchill very clearly did say things about Europe that he did not then follow up with actions when he came into power for the second time in the Indian Summer Premiership of 1951-55. But I'll go on to that if I'm asked about it. But I think it is important, therefore, to remember that he sat on both sides of the House of Commons. He crossed the floor not once but twice. he was many of the great canon of his remarks can be taken by the great political parties to support their own views. And what needs to happen each time is to look at them in the context of when they were spoken, when they were said. For example, we see with his attitude towards Russia, a violently aggressive anti-Soviet tone, of course, at the time that the Bolshevik Revolution broke out in 1917. Then after that, in 1941, he promised Britain would become an ally of the Soviet Union overnight when Hitler had unleashed Blitzkrieg in Operation Barbarossa. Then he turned anti-Soviet again in his great Iron Curtain speech in Fulton, Missouri in March 1946. Then in 1949, he changed his mind back again towards being a peacemonger with regard to the Soviet Union, so much, in fact, that it angered the Eisenhower administration. So you have him changing, what seems like changing his mind, no fewer than four times in the course of his political career. But when you look at each of the actual events themselves, you recognise that there was, throughout it all, one level principle behind it all, which was the British national interest. And again and again, you do see this in the career of Winston Churchill. It very often is not him that that leaves the party so much as the party that that leaves him. So I'd like to sum up before we get on to some questions that Alan's going to ask me, and then hand it over to you. To go back to this point about the lack of spin doctors and the lack of and the way in which he wrote his own speeches always. Nobody ever wrote any speeches for Winston Churchill. And so as a result, you knew that what you were getting from Winston Churchill was him and himself alone. And I think that's an extraordinary thing. We don't see that in modern day politics. I'm not quite sure why we cannot ever see that again in modern day politics, why politicians can't write their own speeches. But nonetheless, they don't tend to. But the great advantage of it was that you knew that it came from his heart. And so in the 1930s, when you had this pressure, enormous pressure, in favour of the policy of appeasement, which Winston Churchill, of course, stood out against, you found moments where he was shouted down in the House of Commons in the 1930s, where the Conservative Party attempted to deselect him from his seat in Epping in 1939 and 1938 and then early 1939. You have him ridiculed in the press, you have him laughed at, you have him viciously attacked, and cartoons drawn of him, people saying that he was a has-been and a loser. And all of this attack did absolutely precisely nothing to alter the message that he was telling the British people and the world about Hitler and the Nazis. He had a sense of where he was going and who he was and what he was saying. Now, partly, of course, that comes from a phenomenal sense of entitlement. Being the grandson of a duke and born in Blenheim Palace, you didn't, by and large, care terribly much about what other people thought of you when you were at the apex of Victorian society. But nonetheless, the way in which he was able to stick to his views in the 1930s was something that I think was so tremendously admirable, and something that we desperately need, that kind of leadership, ladies and gentlemen, I would argue, we desperately need in the world today. So I now would like to hand over to Alan. But this is the one central thing. If you take away nothing from this talk of mine today, please take away this concept that the kind of moral courage shown by Winston Churchill is all too lacking in the world today, and something that we could all do with. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Andrew, for those fascinating opening comments. I'm going to ask a few questions and get your questions ready, because we're going to
come to you. And I think I'll start with the theme you ended up on, a sense of the moral courage. Now, Churchill wasn't shy about, you know, expressing his view on things. And part of the reason he was seen as a has-been in the 1930s was because he had been on the wrong side of certain debates like India and on the abdication issues like that. How do, and arguably in today's world, a politician who makes one mistake is some, you know, is kicked off to the side and that's the end of it. How did Churchill come back from these? Are pretty major defeats, but he came back from it. And what are the lessons politicians today? Should they not be afraid of making mistakes, essentially?
Yes, that's a very good point. I mean, he did make mistake after mistake, blunder, one could say, after blunder. You've mentioned a few. Certainly the gold standard, getting Britain onto the gold standard at the wrong time, at the wrong level in 1925. You mentioned the abdication crisis, supporting the king there. The Dardanelles campaign had led to killing and wounding of 157,000 people, Allied soldiers. It was a brilliant concept, an absolute genius concept that could have knocked the Ottoman Empire out of the Central Powers and changed the course of the First World War, but the implementation of it and the way in which Churchill then stuck to it through thick and thin, all the way through to the point when he was forced to resign. And then 2 months later, of course, the evacuation took place of the Gallipoli Peninsula, shows the lack of judgment that was denounced so much. His opposition to women's suffrage can also be put down as one of these mistakes. But as Churchill said himself in a letter from the trenches to his wife Clementine, "I would have made nothing if I had not made mistakes." And he learnt from them. What we learn, of course, what he learnt from the Dardanelles catastrophe was that he never once in the Second World War overruled the Chiefs of Staff. He would have General Sir Alan Brooke sitting across the green baize table from him down in the Churchill War Rooms, saying, "No, I disagree with you, Prime Minister," cracking pencils in half in his face when he did it. And the result, therefore, was this. The grand strategy that we got came as a result of a creative tension between these two figures, but he never overruled the Chiefs of Staff when all three of the Chiefs of Staff agreed on something. And he was a politician, therefore, who learnt from his mistakes, which is something that is admirable. With regard to your question about whether or not modern politics would allow anyone to make even two of those kind of mistakes, let alone four or five you and I have just numbered, I think says more about modern politics than it does about Winston Churchill. I think you're probably right in that the answer would be no, because you would have, not just, of course, on social media, but also with the sheer aggression of the questioning on radio and television, the constant referring back. I mean, Churchill, even into the 1930s, had people shouting out, heckling his speeches, shouting, "What about the Dardanelles?" And that was 15 years or more earlier. But today, the way in which the incisive questioning again and again of politicians about mistakes that are very much less than any of the ones that Churchill made does make me wonder whether or not he could possibly have survived.
Now, you very kindly left the Brexit question here. Of course, we're going to take heed of your argument that it's impossible to say, of course, what Churchill would have done in the situation. But you did allude to the fact, obviously, Churchill had views on Europe. Those were known views, and I wonder what his approach to Europe would have been in the current sort of set of circumstances.
Well, I'm grabbing again for my book, just owing to the fact that one has to, of course, remember, it's vital, I think, to remember, that Churchill was the primary statesman behind the European movement. He did not want to see again, as he had already seen twice in his lifetime, in his words, "Teuton fight Gaul." And he recognised that in that struggle between France and Germany lay ultimately the destruction of so much that he believed in. By the late 1940s, that was to include the beginning of the end of the British Empire. And so he made these great speeches at The Hague and Strasbourg and Zurich and elsewhere. And in all of them, he was saying, as he actually said it in Zurich, let Europe arise. And he wanted the Germans brought in to the system. However, when he, and he provided, therefore, the most fabulous genius quotations for this movement to start up and to really start to alter the map of Europe. However, ladies and gentlemen, he was in power, of course, between 1951 and 1955, and in that time, 1955 was, of course, only 2 years before the Treaty of Rome was signed that created the European Economic Community, the precursor of the present-day EU. And by 1951, it was clear that if you look very carefully at all of those great speeches of The Hague and Zurich and so on, he never says that Britain should become a member of this community. He prevented Britain from joining the iron and steel the iron and steel community beforehand, Robert Schuman's precursor to the European Union. And he also kept us out of the idea of the European army. And in November 1951, just going to give you a very quick quote of his, to be found on page 925 of the book that you're all yearning to buy, he said, "Our attitude towards further economic developments on the Schuman lines resembles that which we adopt about the European army. We help, we dedicate, we play a part, but we are not merged with and do not forfeit our insular or Commonwealth character. Our first object is the unity and consolidation of the British Commonwealth. Our second, the fraternal association of the English-speaking world. And third," by which of course he meant the special relationship with the United States as well as the Commonwealth, "our third, the United Europe, to which we are a separate, closely and specially related ally and friend. It is only when plans for uniting Europe take a federal form that we ourselves cannot take part, because we cannot subordinate ourselves or the control of British policy to federal authorities." Where do we stand, he then said in a speech in the House of Commons 18 months later. "We are not members of the European Defence Community, nor do we intend to be merged in a federal European system. We feel we have a special relationship to both. This can be expressed by prepositions, by the preposition with, but not of. We are with them, but not of them." He goes on. So it seems pretty clear, if you look very closely at those three speeches that he made in the late 1940s, and then at the minutes he was writing, the speeches he made in the House of Commons in the early 1950s, that he very much wanted what has become the European Union to succeed and to become a great force in the world. But he also did not want Britain to be part of it.
And my final question, before I open it up, is about the sort of sense of decline. Now, we look out today and a lot of people think Britain is in decline. Actually, you'll have seen last week our own geopolitical capability audit put Britain still at number two in the world, if you look at the indices we use to calculate that.
That we use.
Exactly. But scientifically done, not a sort of talking heads game. But of course, Churchill dealt with decline a lot through his career. I mean, obviously in the 30s, people were saying, we can't do this rearmament business, we're not able to stand up to Hitler and all that, we need to come to a solution. Latterly in his career, obviously, he'd seen Britain slip off, say, from the number one spot. He had to deal with that. And yet, we always, of course, associate Churchill with an indomitable spirit and the sense that Britain could do greater. What's the message for that for today?
Well, you're right, of course, and it hurt in late 1943, early 1944, when it became very clear that the United States had taken Britain's place as the head of the Western world. He, of course, didn't mention this publicly, and he couldn't mention this publicly, and he certainly couldn't do so in a negative tone. However, it was always part of his sense of Britain and its empire that it should be the leading power in the world. And when it was clear by 1940, certainly by the early part of 1944, that was not the case, after John Curtin made his speech in 1942 saying that Australia looked to America rather than Britain for its defence, for example. In the calendar year 1944, when Britain produced 28,000 warplanes and the Russians and Germans produced 40,000 each. America produced 98,000 warplanes. So very clearly by that stage, Britain was not going to be top dog power any longer, and he had to get used to it. And by the time he was slipping into his dotage in the late 1950s and early 1960s, he told his private secretary, his last private secretary, Sir Anthony Montague Brown, that he considered his career to have been a failure. Because, of course, the thing that he had dedicated himself to back in the late 1890s as a subaltern in the northwest frontier of India, the protection of the British Empire, was no more. And the British Empire, those parts that hadn't already been given away, were being given away in that period. And so this man who we consider to be one of the great success stories of the 20th century, rightly, I believe, himself believed himself to have been a failure because of this concept of decline that you mentioned.
Great. Okay, let's open up to questions. Could you give your name and any affiliation for Grenoble? Let's take three at a time, because there's so many. I'm going to start over there, there, and then here, and then we'll move over that
way. I can't guarantee to remember three at a time.
Okay, hi. David Paxton, I'm a partner at law firm Charles Russell Speechleys. My question is, what would Churchill's view have been about Britain's interventionist policies and actions in the Middle East over the last 15 years?
Okay, question over here,
coming
here.
Yes, please forgive me, my question is not specifically about Churchill. Was it me you were?
Yes.
Yeah. But having read your book,
Nathan.
Edward Ben Nathan, no specific affiliation, forgive me. I was flabbergasted to learn about Chamberlain ceding the Irish treaty ports, an act that seems to me to be verging on treason, and yet it doesn't seem to be known. How come?
And over here.
Thank you. My name is John Dobson from the Indian Sunday Guardian. Churchill lived in a structured society, structures which are now breaking down through populism. How would Churchill react to populism?
Great. Well, I will take the easiest ones first, obviously. No, I won't. I'll go with David to begin with. Interventionism in the Middle East. Well, you could, of course, it was he who said at the time of the Suez crisis that, or at least he's reputed to have said, I found it very difficult to track down a contemporaneous reference to prove this. Nonetheless, and very often when Churchill had clever remarks attributed to him, he didn't officiously go out of the way to deny having said them.
Who does?
No. But it was he who said that he wouldn't have had he wouldn't have had the bravery to have gone into Suez, but then after that he wouldn't have had the bravery to come out of Suez in the way that we did as well. So I think overall he was perfectly much in favour of interventions like the Mossadegh overthrow in Iran in 1953, which the CIA was supportive of the local Iranians on the ground over that, and of course MI6 was as well. But in terms of full-scale invasions, he was very good at cutting his cloth, and Britain by the but certainly by the time of the Suez crisis, was not really in a position to engage in any full-scale attacks on our own without the United States, which is why at the time of his resignation in April 1955, he told the cabinet, never be split from the Americans, never, never, never. Now, the next question is Edwards. About the Irish treaty ports and why we don't know more about them.
Yeah.
I think the primary reason is that not enough people have read chapter 33 of my book, in which the whole horrible, ghastly, painful story is laid out as well as I can lay it out. Well, basically is the story, ladies and gentlemen, is that in 1939, the year before the Second World War broke out, and at a time when any sentient being must have noticed that Germany was a dangerous power, only likely to become more dangerous, the Chamberlain government completely unilaterally and for nothing in return but goodwill gave three of the treaty ports, i.e. the ports that Britain was allowed to keep under the Treaty of 1922 that founded ERA, founded the Irish Free State, and just handed them back, even though they were they would have proved invaluable in order to have helped us track U-boats on the in the Atlantic. And the Admiralty at the end of the war did a pretty scientific analysis, and they worked out that the tens of thousands of tons of shipping, but also if not hundreds of thousands, the number is in the book, but also at least 5,000 British sailors' lives would have been saved if we'd managed to operate out of those three ports. So, as you say, yes, in amongst the many reasons that Neville Chamberlain proved an incubus by 1939, that was certainly 1938, 1939. That was certainly one of them. John, populism. Well, you know, Winston Churchill, he could play the populist card himself pretty effectively. The time I would look at most to demonstrate that would be his period before the First World War, and at the time of the People's Budget, and the speeches that he gave attacking the aristocracy and the hereditary element in the House of Lords, of course, which was entirely hereditary at that time, and which was blocking the People's Budget. The various speeches, as I say, the most incendiary ones are in this book, attacking the establishment effectively, and they drew blood. They had the king complaining to his private secretary, who then wrote to the Times. They had the members of his own family, of course, coming from an aristocratic family himself. He was effectively attacking six of his cousins who were sitting on the Tory benches of the House of Lords, and he was capable of. I'm not going to say rabble rousing, because he wasn't a rabble rouser, but boy, the rabble could be roused by some of the remarks he made. So I don't think we can hold him up necessarily all the way through his life as an anti-populist figure. However, what he tended not to do was to encourage the rabble to do anything more than vote. That is, all he ever asked from anybody was for a vote in peacetime. And so it's, I think, slightly different from some of the rabble-rousing we get in politics today, where people are very clearly being whipped up to do more than just put an X in the box.
Great. Let's take another round. One,
back there, two there, three. Yeah, okay. Thanks, Nick Bosenkirk from the Imperial College. I already own a signed copy.
Mm-hmm. Good for you. You must have a friend, though.
It's a little joke about which Jim and Shaw will come to that later. But isn't one great obstacle to his contemporary relevance in that after what you rightly mentioned, the speeches on free trade, the backing of the insurance bills and so on, he had absolutely no contribution of his own on domestic policy, economic or social at all, and made a complete mess of getting an agreed agenda on reconstruction, even though the First War experience rather pointed to me for that, at the end of the Second War. And what's more, he became extremely reactionary. I mean, one of the worst episodes I remember in the Indian summer is not mentioned in the books, is the persecution of gay people by Maxwell Fine, where he revived legislation which had been quite dormant. So he became culturally much more reactionary at the time.
Okay. Yeah, gentlemen, is there a blue? Yes.
Me?
Yes, you. Yeah.
Graham Perry, my link is I studied at Churchill College, so Churchill is part of my upbringing. Just briefly, my family were very much of the left. They disliked Churchill for the reasons you mentioned, but they were second to none in respecting the role that he played. displayed as a leader in terms of his speeches. They said nothing else saved Britain as much as his voice crackling over the airwaves. My question is an unusual one, but in a radio program I listened to recently, a link was made between Churchill's speeches and his love of musical. Is there anything in that that you know about?
Okay. Was that the radio program that I made a couple of years ago?
It was. I heard it 6 months ago, but I'm pretty sure you were prominent in it.
Right. Okay. Now I know exactly what you mean. Good. Okay.
Michael Levine, Henry Jackson Society, a member. Many years ago, as a youngster, even younger than I am now, I spent several hours down the road queuing up to see the gentleman lying in state. The question I'd like to ask you, without breaching any biographer's etiquette, is what do you believe that your book gives us that Martin Gilbert's tones might not?
Well, actually, I'm going to start with the last one first, if that's okay. Because it's an extraordinary cornucopia of new information that's come out in the last 10 years since Martin's... Well, Martin's single volume biography, of course, was published in 1992, which is a quarter of a century ago now. But even in the last 10 years, there has been an enormous amount. The gentleman who worked at Churchill College, who was at Churchill College, might know that we have, since the last major biography of Churchill, had 41 sets of papers delivered to deposited with the archives, which are of the papers of people like Mary Soames, and there's all of the Randolph Churchill papers that are there now. Many other people who work with Churchill, Valentine Lawford, for example. It's a very impressive new set of sources there. On top of that, the Queen allowed me to be the first Churchill biographer to use her father's diaries. And Churchill met King George VI every Tuesday of the Second World War, and Churchill trusted the King with every major secret of the war, the ultra decrypts, the nuclear secret, for example, and very much else, and then wrote down everything that Churchill said. We've got the Maisky diaries, the diaries of the Russian ambassador Ivan Maisky, 1932 to 43, who met Churchill a lot during the period in the run-up to the Nazi-Soviet pact. I myself found the verbatim accounts of the war cabinet when I was writing my book Masters and Commanders, and I've used things from that also in this. I was very fortunate also to have access to Pamela Harriman's love letters. So all in all, it really is an avalanche of new material, and I think in certainly the whole of the second half of this book, there will be something on every page that will not have appeared in any Winston Churchill biography before. Graham, the speeches. Your parents really... knocked it on the head. The way in which his eloquence and his command of the English language, using the English tongue in words that will so sublime that they will live for as long as our language does, was undoubtedly instrumental in fighting against demoralisation of the British people during the Second World War, and the Western world indeed during the Second World War. Now, that is not just to say that was... it might have been his primary contribution, but it certainly wasn't his sole contribution. I think it's very important to remember the input that he did have, the positive input that he did have on strategy, on grand strategy. I go into that in some detail. But no, of course you're right. Those speeches that many of us actually can remember the phraseology are things that will live forever. And when you look at how he wrote those speeches, he actually started not through endless practice, although the number of pages of his collected speeches runs to 8,000 pages. Nonetheless, when he started, he did it from the idea of theory rather than just endless practice. He worked out exactly the way in which he wanted to be a public speaker in ways that I go into in early part of this book. With regard to Nick and the domestic policy, I mean, he was responsible for large areas of the creation of the welfare state, along with David Lloyd George, the Mines Act, the children, bank holidays, ladies not having to work the full 9 to 5 without sitting down in shops and so on. There is a progressive domestic agenda. He didn't oppose things like the National Health Service when he was leader of the opposition. I think it's very difficult to denounce him as a reactionary when he was leader of the opposition. And with regard to gay rights, of course, you are correct. He himself had lots of gay friends. He had absolutely no prejudice against the, I think I list in a footnote, at least 10 close friends of his who were active homosexuals. And at no point in the whole Churchillian canon have I found anything derogatory about them. However, the law did not change to reflect that until, I think, the late 1960s, wasn't it? So I don't think that Winston Churchill can be solely or even primarily blamed for that terrible thing that happened to gay people for half a century or so.
Another sweep of the room. There,
Three
here.
Thank you. Jeremy Havardi, no affiliation, but author of one of the 1009 books. My question is about Churchill's political philosophy. Do you think that Churchill was primarily a conservative with a few liberal instincts, or primarily a liberal with a few conservative instincts?
I'm Barry Cameron. I'm a member of the International Churchill Society. Being in power, particularly in the war, must have been very lonely, not in terms of the help he got from his wife and family, but the fact that he walked in the House of Commons chamber and been cheered by Labour more than the Conservatives originally. Had the death of F.E. Smith, his close friend, and later on the accidental death of Lawrence Arabia, affected him to that he needed more confidants than he had, that there were not enough men around him and women he could trust politically?
In the window, yeah.
I'm James Kidner. I work for a technology company called Improbable. My father guarded Churchill at Chequers during the war. He'd been a medical student before he joined up, and he talked about the terror of this frail, drunken old man slippering about in his slippers with a glass of whiskey in one hand and very well-polished stairs behind him. My question, I want to bring up the B word, and I don't mean Blenheim or the Bolsheviks or even Brexit. I want to raise the question of Boris. What's your assessment of Boris Johnson's short biography, or a short book on Churchill?
Well, starting with the first one, about whether he was a liberal or a conservative, or liberal with conservative instincts or so on. Actually, he was a conservative, but a specific type of conservative. He took from his father, along with many other things from his father who despised him and showed him nothing really but contempt in his life. Nonetheless, he followed his father's political principles, which were those of Disraelian Tory democracy. And he considered himself a Tory Democrat, whether he was in a Tory government or a Liberal one. And it was the thing that set him very much against, is why he could never have joined a Labour government, for example. He considered that the creation of the welfare state that I mentioned earlier, that he undertook with Lloyd George, was actually conducive to Tory Democrat principles. And they were pretty wide principles. In fact, Lord Randolph Churchill said that when asked about what Tory democracy was, he answered, opportunism mostly. But I think there's actually much more to it than that. It was it did have broad principles, and if you look closely at them, he didn't diverge from them, whichever party he was in. Next question, Barry. The loneliness after the death of F.E. Yes, I think the whole the whole appeasement debate would have been different if he had had F.E. and
actually, Lawrence of Arabia, you never know how he would have dealt with it as well. If you'd had a few more voices rather than Churchill's lone siren voice, Churchill being considered to have had such a problem with his judgment over his lifetime. And it wasn't just them. He lost five or six friends, in fact, in the 1930s. Ralph Wigram, of course, also of the Foreign Office, being another one who had been helpful to him in that period. But what it did, I think, was to and what one might be able, in fact, to draw a line between that and his use of the king as a confidant in his weekly audiences, in his Tuesday audiences, because he did use him as a confidant, knowing that, of course, the king was one of the very few people in Westminster who wasn't after his job. He also, but he did develop friends as well. He had an extraordinary capacity for friendship, and you see this very much with the membership of the other club that I mentioned earlier. So, so yes, I think that's a good point to make. And James, with regard to your father, just because Winston Churchill drank whiskey did not mean he was drunk. He actually had an extraordinary capacity for alcohol. The journalist C.P. Scott, who knew Churchill well, said that that Winston Churchill couldn't have been an alcoholic because no alcoholic could drink that much. and you see again and again the way in which he was... he was in the 2,194 days of the Second World War. He was not actually seen by those around him to have been drunk, except on one occasion in March 1944, when everybody agreed that he was undoubtedly drunk. And what they did was simply to pretend the next morning that the meeting hadn't happened, and they had the entire meeting all over again as though the drunken one the night before had not taken place. So no decisions were taken as a result of Winston Churchill being drunk. Your question about Boris and Boris's book, I loved that book. It it had 14 excellent anecdotes in it about Churchill, two of which were true.
Very good. And on we move. All right, come here. One, two, three. Yes, finally a lady. Great.
Michael McLean, no known links with Churchill. Andrew, you've had one other great hero, Napoleon. Are there any parallels you would draw in terms of moral courage or strategic sweep or opportunism, as you mentioned just now? You once wrote a compare and contrast on Churchill and Hitler, as I recall. Are
more contrast than compare.
Are they in entirely different silos, or does your I won't say fixation with them, but your the way in which you've written so extensively and incisively about each of them, does it say more about them or more about you?
Yes, my name is Hugh Edwards. I'm a chartered accountant. Just to say that I'm actually old enough to have heard Winston Churchill make a speech in public at the 1959 election. And it was still a very powerful, coherent speech. The one thing I thought was, thank God, Winston Churchill was not surrounded by yes men during the war. He had Alan Brooke, who was not. And the other point occurs to me with Clement Attlee and Winston Churchill, weren't they in some respects odd couple as Prime Minister and Deputy Prime Minister? And people sneer at Clement Attlee, but I suspect Churchill had a very great respect for him and called him a great patriot. And there's a nice story that when he came back to power in 51 and found that the plans for a nuclear deterrent by Britain were far advanced, he was absolutely astonished, and you know, his jaw dropped, which didn't happen very often.
Sandra Dangle with a niece currently at Churchill College. You mentioned before that Churchill pursued certain actions even though they were wrong, but he stuck at it. What do you think he would say of the current leadership and the shambles that are going on in Parliament, where there is no deviation to the Prime Minister's plan?
Michael, yes. Winston Churchill admired Napoleon enormously. He had his bust on his desk for most of his life, almost all his working life. There was also one at Chartwell. He collected Churchill books about Napoleon and had a fine Napoleonic library, which you can see at Churchill College. He had a belief that that Napoleon was driven by destiny as well as ambition, and you can see, of course, very much the overlaps there with himself. And he, at one stage, wanted to write Napoleon's biography, which I think would have been one of the greatest books of the 20th century if he'd done that. Possibly less great an artistic achievement might have been his other great plan, which was to have Charlie Chaplin play Napoleon. We don't know how that would have worked out. But no, very, very clearly, and it has been, there was a very good, somebody mentioned Alan Packwood here. Alan has written a very good article in Finest Hour, the magazine of the International Churchill Society, which, if any of you are not members here, I do recommend that you join. It's a wonderful organisation. That you see in that essay the amount of overlaps between Churchill and Napoleon, and you see that he was therefore one of the heroes against which he measured himself. The others, of course, being Clemenceau during the First World War, his own great ancestor, the first Duke of Marlborough, William Pitt the Younger, and very few others. Those are the sort of key figures, I think. The next question from Hugh. Yes, his personal, I mean, of course he had to be critical of Attlee in public, especially as he was leader of the opposition, and later also when he was Prime Minister, when the Great Coalition had broken up in May 1945. But his personal fondness for Attlee and his admiration for Attlee, which undoubtedly he had both of those things, stemmed from two things, I think. The first being that Attlee was the last man off Gallipoli. He was in charge of the last unit to leave the Gallipoli Peninsula in January 1916. And he always thought that the Gallipoli campaign was a brilliant idea, badly executed. And so Churchill would have admire him for that. He also admired him for his incredibly patriotic actions on the 10th to the 13th of May 1940, in which he did not demand any particular number of cabinet posts and war cabinet posts when Churchill was setting up his first cabinet. It was, of course, that day, we were talking about destiny earlier, that Churchill said, "I felt as if I were walking with destiny and that all my past life had been but a preparation for this hour and for this trial." And when Attlee came to enter the national government, he didn't set preconditions, which he could have done. And Churchill, for the rest of his life, saw that as one of the great patriotic moments. And what fits in very well with what you also said about how he came back and found the nuclear bomb had been progressing as fast as it could be. Of course, Attlee did that without telling the cabinet and hiding the financing of the nuclear bomb, which was a huge outlay, as you can imagine, entirely in the Secret Service funds. So Churchill thought of Attlee, rightly in my view, as a patriot. And the last question was about... I don't think I did say that Churchill carried on regardless, even though he knew something was wrong.
He might not have known it was wrong. You said something at the very beginning of your speech that
Anyhow.
Correct me if I'm wrong, he carried on with things.
Oh, he carried on saying the same thing?
Yes.
Yes, absolutely, even though everybody else said he was wrong.
Yes.
Yes, no, absolutely, that's the... But he himself thought he was right, clearly. Yeah, good. Okay. Sorry, it would have been very nerve-wracking if you'd come away with that message.
So it's exactly what's going on today?
It's not precisely what's going on today, I think, because again, each of the people who are the great players in this Brexit drama also believe that they are right. And what I'm more concerned about is the people that jab and weave, that alter their stances, that are swayed much more by opinion polls and who's likely to win the next election than saying what they believe is right for the country.
Yeah.
I think there's a huge difference between the two, and Winston Churchill would undoubtedly have been one of the latter. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much indeed.
He's written a brilliant one-volume biography. He managed to finish the section in 1 hour on the dot without even any prompting. I want to, you know, the two things I want to point out, obviously, the moral fortitude and courage that Churchill had shown Andrew brought that out, and also the leading public opinion not following it. Clearly the point's there. If you are interested more in Churchill, please do join the International Churchill Society. We've got Jenny Churchill and Lawrence Geller, who represent the Society here. You can have a chat with them. And Andrew, of course, is going to be outside now, where you can pick up a copy of this fine book at a very reasonable rate, and he will even sign it for you.